Good afternoon, everyone. A warm welcome to you from the Medlife E-Consult team. I'm Anuja, your host for this afternoon. I'm joined by Chirag. He's also from the Medlife E-Consult team. He'll be taking care of the technicalities during the presentation. Thank you so much for joining us today for the webinar, HIV Awareness, The Change Begins With Me. Now, before we begin, please type in where you are from and just put in a hello to us in the little chat box below. We'd love to know where you're from. I can see quite a few attendees here. Now, as part of the plan to hold awareness webinars on various health issues plaguing the people of this country, Medlife eConsult team decided on the topic of HIV/AIDS this month. We also had the World AIDS Day recently on the 1st of December, which brought to the forefront the question, where does this country now stand in its efforts to completely eradicate AIDS? And here it's heartening to note that the epidemic of HIV/AIDS has definitely slowed down in our country. Between 2010 and 2017, statistics say that AIDS-related deaths fell by 56%. And new infections declined by 27%. However, India is still home to the third largest HIV epidemic in the world, despite the statistics. The epidemic is largely driven by sexual transmissions here. In fact, 86% of the new infections between 2017 and 2018 occurred due to sexual transmissions. Now, awareness is the key to curtail and finally put an end to this epidemic. That is the very objective of this webinar, to raise awareness. To that end, we have with us today two experts on the subject of HIV/AIDS. The first doctor that we have with us today is a very well-known name amongst HIV and AIDS support groups, a doctor who is in high demand among HIV patients, Dr. Premchand. Dr. Premchand is an HIV and AIDS specialist with over 37 years of experience in the field of treating HIV and AIDS patients. He has so far treated 35,000 AIDS patients and is currently treating approximately 3,000 patients from all over India as well as from South Africa. His expertise lies in counseling and treating the patients, as well as guiding their family members and their support network. Dr. Premchand completed his MBBS in 1981 and has a fellowship in HIV from CMC Vellore. He has worked with many government and private HIV organizations throughout the country, and he has also conducted many awareness programs on HIV. So welcome, Dr. Premchand, and thank you so much for being with us here today. The other guest is Dr. Sushma. Dr. Sushma passed her MBBS from Gandhi Medical College, Hyderabad. She also completed her MBA on healthcare from IIM Bangalore. She has 20 years of experience and has also worked in USA, Canada, and India. Currently, she's working as an e-consultation process specialist at MetLife. She also has her own clinic called Samriddhi Polyclinic, where she practices as a general practitioner. She also works as a medical consultant at Ideal Protein. Thank you so much for joining us today, Dr. Sushma. And we will first start with a presentation by Dr. Sushma on HIV/AIDS and then move on to the Ask the Doctor round, where you, that's our audience, can get all your doubts clarified about this disease by Dr. Premchand, our specialist today. We encourage you to make full use of this opportunity to ask all your questions. And to ask your questions, you can just type in your question into the little chat box below. I will read out your question. You can type in your question anonymously, by the way, so your names will not be read out. So without further ado, I invite Dr. Sushma to start the presentation. Dr. Sushma.
Thanks, Anuja. Hi, everyone. This is Dr. Sushma. I would be taking briefly about HIV and what are the topics we would be covering today in this presentation. So the topics covered would be, what is HIV and how does the virus look, and how is HIV transmitted, and the different transmission methods, the symptoms of HIV, treatment of HIV, and what is AIDS, symptoms of AIDS, and what are the most common infections during AIDS, again, treatment for AIDS, and lastly but not the least, HIV prevention and support. So what is HIV? And HIV is nothing but human immunodeficiency virus. The name itself tells that the virus attacks the immune system of a normal human being. Once a person is infected with HIV, it attacks the defense cells. Those are nothing but the immune cells. And it is a type of white blood cell in the immune system called the T helper cells, which are mainly affected by the HIV virus. So what happens? In a natural human being, we have these defense cells which kill off the infections once they enter. But in a HIV infected person, they are prone for even the most simplest of infections because the defense cells are destroyed. So it weakens the body in a HIV infected person and makes the body vulnerable to infections and cancer. So how does the HIV virus looks like? The first picture shows the HIV virus in the bluish purple, like a cactus, the thorny spikes, and those are the RBCs, the biconcave RBCs. And the second picture shows it's a womb where you see the fetus and the umbilical cord, and it clearly shows the HIV virus transmits through the placenta, that is from mother to the baby. Those are the thorny viruses which are entering the placenta into the baby, the fetus. So how is HIV transmitted? Through infected bodily fluids and through direct entry into the body. So not all the bodily fluids are harmful. Only the bodily fluids that can infect the HIV or transmit the HIV are blood, vaginal fluids, semen, and breast milk. Remember, these are the four fluids which transmit HIV virus from a person to person. And the harmless bodily fluids. The bodily fluids through which HIV cannot be transmitted are saliva or spit. So kissing a HIV positive person does not transmit HIV to the non-HIV infected person. Similarly, sweat, tears, and urines, these are harmless bodily fluids which cannot transmit the HIV virus. So what are the different transmission methods? Number one, unprotected sex with HIV positive person. And infected syringes, especially with IV drug abuse, who share their needles, and infected mother to baby during pregnancy and delivery. We have seen the slide where there is a transmission through the placenta, and while breastfeeding through breast milk, and blood transfusions. Currently, the blood is screened for HIV, hepatitis B and C virus before transfusing, and through organ transplants. These are the different transmission methods through which HIV is transmitted from one person to another. So this slide talks about the window period and the progression of HIV. So what is window period? The period between the exposure to the HIV virus and the onset of a full-blown infection is 3 months, which is known as the window period. So once the HIV virus gets into a person, it doesn't show up immediately. So that is the window period. So if you look at the schematic representation of the HIV progression, you see this is these are the tubes which show the blood. And the blue colored cells are nothing but the CD4 cells. CD4 cells are the main immune cells which are affected in HIV infection. And our doctor or the HIV expert will mainly ask the HIV positive person to get his CD4 cell count checked regularly. So this plays a crucial role in telling us what are the main types of infections depending on the CD4 cell count. So before HIV infection, our body has ample amount of CD4 cells, as seen in the first test tube, which shows the blue colored cells. So once the infection, that is once the virus enters our body, infection sets in. And it takes about weeks to months for acute HIV infection to present. The second tube shows the thorny cells are nothing but the virus, that is the HIV RNA virus. And the blue ones are the CD4 cells. They coexist together. Then next comes the chronic HIV infection, where you see three tubes. The first tube shows ample amount of CD4 cells, lesser HIV virus. The second one shows increasing HIV virus and slowly declining CD4 cell count. The third tube shows predominance of HIV virus and declining CD4 cell count. This is a chronic or the HIV infection. And the final one is the AIDS. AIDS sets in when the viral load increases. As you see, more number of HIV viruses are seen and the CD4 cell count totally falls. AIDS sets in when CD4 cell count falls below 200 cells per cubic millimeter. Then comes, what are the symptoms of HIV? You cannot rely on symptoms to know if you are infected with HIV. The only sure way is to get tested for HIV. So a HIV infected person can be totally asymptomatic like any other normal person. Or he can show minor symptoms like flu-like symptoms that you during the acute HIV period. Flu-like symptoms that occurs days to weeks after contracting HIV. And during chronic HIV, this is the latent or asymptomatic stage which can last for several years. Totally, absolutely free of symptoms. This is the latent or the asymptomatic phase. Then comes the AIDS phase. This occurs when, as discussed previously, CD4 cell count, when it falls below 200 cells per cubic millimeter, AIDS sets in. And what happens here is it makes a person vulnerable to the opportunistic infections and AIDS-defining conditions. And what is the scenario of HIV in India? As Anuja has nicely mentioned that India has the largest population of HIV positive people with about 2.1 million people currently living in HIV. And what is the main cause of this HIV epidemic in India is unprotected sex. Similarly, the highest prevalence in the age group is sexually active years or the reproductive years, 14 years to 49 years. And where do we see the highest prevalence of HIV in India? It's the northeastern states of Manipur, Mizoram, and Nagaland. Here the scenario is because of high prevalence of drug abuse using these syringes. And who are the most prone for HIV infections? The people most prone to HIV in India are sex workers because they have unprotected sex with multiple partners, and men who have sex with men, people indulging in drug abuse by sharing syringes, transgenders, migrant laborers who are moving from one place to another constantly, and truck drivers. What is the treatment for HIV? Heart therapy. Heart therapy is nothing but highly active antiretroviral therapy. It is use of multiple drugs to tackle the HIV virus burden, to maintain the functions of the immune system, and to prevent opportunistic infections that often lead to death. So HIV virus per se does not cause the death. The death in a HIV or AIDS patient is because of the infections he or she gets during that period. So how did they come to heart therapy? There was constant research happening on HIV and AIDS. Especially there was a promising results with three-duct therapy, that is with use of two nucleoside reverse transcriptase inhibitors and a protease inhibitor indinavir, and thus resulted in introduction of heart therapy. So in India, the most popular regime as followed by NACO. NACO is nothing but National AIDS Control Organization. It is zidovudine or tenofovir with lamivudine with nevirapine, efavirenz or atazanavir and ritonavir. This is the most popular regime released by NACO. So as discussed, treatment for HIV. HIV virus cannot be eradicated from an infected person. You have to remember, once the virus enters the body, it will not leave the body. Why do we have to treat the HIV then? Treatment is only targeted towards prolongation of life and improving the quality of life, decreasing the viral load, improvement in immunity, and reducing HIV transmission. We can contain the virus. We can delay the progression of HIV to AIDS with treatment. That is why treatment for HIV is very, very important. And if you start early, what are the benefits of starting early? Reduction in morbidity and mortality due to different infections that occur based on the different CD4 cell count a HIV positive person shows, and delay or prevention of immunosuppression, decreased antiretroviral resistance. Like as many other antibiotics or other drugs, HIV medications can have resistance. So by starting early, this type of resistance to heart therapy decreases. So the treatment becomes more effective at this point. Decreased sexual transmission of HIV. So HIV to AIDS. Not everyone with HIV will have AIDS, But if not treated with antiretroviral medicines, it will progress to AIDS. So a person who is HIV positive but has a strong immune system will take many years or in fact may not progress to AIDS also, especially with early treatment with heart therapy and adherence to it. So a HIV person can remain AIDS free till 8 to 10 years, after which the immune system begins to fail. Then the person becomes an AIDS patient. So what is AIDS? AIDS is nothing but acquired immunodeficiency syndrome. It is the final and most severe stage of HIV. This occurs when the virus completely breaks down the immune system of a HIV positive person. So AIDS patients have severe opportunistic infections and typically have their CD4 count less than 200 cells per cubic millimeter. Without treatment, survival is less than 2 to 3 years once AIDS sets in. So what are the symptoms of AIDS? The symptoms of AIDS are mostly because of the type of infections that occur during that period, and most commonly include high fever, constant high fever, constant sweating, fatigue, chronic diarrhea, white spots or lesions on the tongue, tremendous weight loss, and rashes on the skin. So what are the most common infections during AIDS? An AIDS-infected person is susceptible to TB, tuberculosis. This is one of the most common manifestation of an AIDS patient. 50% of HIV positive people who develop AIDS show tuberculosis. And this tuberculosis is mostly resistant to many of the anti-tuberculous therapy. Cytomegalovirus, it causes retinitis, that is infection of the retina in the eye. Candidiasis, it is a fungal infection which causes oral thrush, which is seen as white patches in the mouth. Cryptococcal meningitis, fungal infection of the layers of brain and spinal cord. Toxoplasmosis, CT scan of the brain shows ring enhancing lesions which are caused by a protozoa called Toxoplasma gondii. Cryptosporidiosis, it is a parasitic infection which manifests as continuous chronic diarrhea and causes wasting. Wasting is malnourishment in an AIDS patient. Neurological complications, AIDS dementia, peripheral neuropathy, and kidney diseases, both due to HIV infection causing HIV nephropathy and as a side effect of heart therapy. And AIDS patients are prone for many cancers. Most common of them are lymphoma and Kaposi's sarcoma. Lymphoma is nothing but malignant cancer cells of lymph system, and non-Hodgkin's lymphoma is very high in AIDS patients. Kaposi's sarcoma, it is a type of soft tissue lesion specific to AIDS patients caused by herpes virus 8, that is HHV-8. So you can see here the symptoms and the infections are caused by the most common and rare and common fungal infections. Common are candidiasis and the rare are fungal parasitic infections such as cryptosporidiosis and toxoplasma such as protozoal infections. So what is the treatment for AIDS? First, without treatment, at least 50% of HIV positive patients develop full-blown AIDS within 10 years. So by this time, the patient becomes very thin and emaciated due to severe infections, which are usually resistant to many antibiotics. The best way is to prevent or slow the progression to AIDS. Treatment involves treating the opportunistic infections, for example, treatment of TB along with Bactrim for 2 weeks, treatment with antifungals for fungal infections, etc. Expert doctor designs the treatment based on the immune status of the HIV infected person, type of infection that is seen at that period of time when AIDS sets in. So, what is the best way? Prevention is better than cure. As the saying goes, best way is to prevent HIV infection. And what are the different ways a person can prevent HIV infection is? Have protected sex, use condoms. Best option would to make sure your partner is HIV free. Make sure the syringes used in any clinic are new and unused. Get immediate treatment if you are HIV positive and pregnant, because as we have seen, transplacental transmission, that is transmission from mother to child, occurs. So early treatment would reduce the risk of infecting a baby with HIV. And studies have suggested male circumcision can significantly reduce the risk of HIV for a man. So post-exposure prophylaxis, that is once a person gets infected knowingly, unknowingly with HIV and he or she comes to know that they are infected with HIV, they will get best remedy if it is started within 2 hours of exposure, and it should be continued for 4 weeks. The drug regimen is again decided by an expert doctor based on his or her immune status. So the different HIV support groups, what we have in India, the Indian government is currently providing free ART medicines, that is antiretroviral therapy medicines. And what are the few support groups you can reach out to India are NACO, as I mentioned, it is nothing but National AIDS Control Organization. The toll-free number is 1097. Here, a person can call this number and can get psychological support, any counseling, any queries related to HIV free of cost with utmost privacy. And there are certain groups such as Positive People Group in Goa. In 1992, a person by name Dominic D'Souza challenged the government. Before 2000 and early 2000, there was a lot of stigma attached around HIV positive people. That is, they were always kept in isolation and the society used to look down upon them like a stigma. So he fought for this with the government and made sure that HIV positive people also get equal opportunities. Then there is another group called Positive Sathi from Chennai, which facilitates marriages and companionship between HIV positive people. Then we have a Committed Communities Development Trust, CCDT, an organization that caters home-based care by providing psychosocial, nutritional, educational, legal and medical support to strengthen the capacity of a family. You have to remember, any HIV positive person, you have to support, counsel the entire family. It is not just that person. Family and friends support makes a lot of difference. So we are going to talk about the community support. Awareness programs are conducted, can be conducted to remove the stigma attached. Mostly there is a stigma that, you know, by touching a HIV positive person or sharing the room or utensils or even the clothes, HIV is transmitted. No, HIV cannot be transmitted that way. Such type of awareness has to be conducted among all the people to remove the stigma attached to it. Counseling. You need to counsel a HIV positive person along with the family because they are more prone for depression. Why? Because the heart therapy, the therapy we give for HIV positive people have prolonged the lifespan even up to 20 years. So they can live a normal life for up to 20 years with treatment adherence, timely support and proper counseling and with the family and friends support. So a HIV positive person can live like any diabetic or hypertensive person who is taking the treatment and going to a physician to get him or herself checked for sugars and blood pressure continuously. In a similar way, a HIV positive person can lead a normal life up, even up to 20 years if they follow the proper regimen and treatment, then they adhere to the treatment. And of course, the spiritual support, whatever belief they ail from, they can take support from the churches, temples or mosques, and this belief can help them and strengthen their fight against HIV. Thank you, everyone.
Dr. Sushma, thank you. That was an in-depth coverage and very enlightening. So now the forum is open to the audience to ask questions. So please ask away. Dr. Premchand is here with us. He's an expert with over 30 years of experience in AIDS and HIV. In fact, we already have questions coming in. We are listening. Dr. Premchand, here's the first question for you. Can you hear me, Dr. Premchand?
Yes.
Yeah. So here's one question which has come in. Are there any medicines that can prevent HIV from occurring within the first few hours of having sexual intercourse with a possibly HIV positive person?
So far, no medicine has been detected for such a way. Only thing is we can prevent HIV by a prick injury, means any needle stick injury or a knife injury or a surgical knife injury. That is an unnatural way of pricking. That can be prevented with post-exposure prophylaxis with some good antiretroviral medicines. We can prevent in such a way. But in this natural course of HIV is through intercourse only. That is the natural course of transmission of the disease is through intercourse only. In that way, if even a one intercourse is sufficient enough to get transmission sometimes. Sometimes 100 times of intercourse may not transmit the disease in some times. So that is the virulence of the virus and the presence of a viral load present at the time of intercourse. That all depends on so many factors. But so far, no medicine for that to prevent HIV through that one intercourse is not detected.
Okay, Dr. Premchand. There's another question. Yeah, you want to add something more, Dr. Premchand?
No. Is it the sufficient answer or anything to be added?
I think the answer is sufficient unless the person comes back with any. If you are still listening, if you have any more questions, just type in over there in the little chat box, and I will ask Dr. Premchand again. If you need to ask anything over and above what Dr. Premchand has described, I'll move on to the next question, Dr. Premchand. The next question the person's asking, can I get infected with HIV if I accidentally touch, I think what this person means is touch blood. Okay, I think what the person means is if I accidentally touch the bleeding wound of an HIV infected person.
No, not at all. Because and this is a wonderful question, so many people have this doubt in and around India and in the world. You see, with our clean hands, hygienic hands, you can put your hand in a bucket full of HIV blood, nothing will happen to the human. But unless otherwise, the hand must be cleaned and hand must be hygienic. And hand must be injury-free, hand must be scratch-free, and no blood from the healthy hand. If you put the hand, which is a healthy and hygienic, nothing will happen. Even if you put your hand on the blood of an HIV patient, nothing will happen to the person who puts the hand on the HIV blood. Nothing will happen. Never and ever it transmits through that type of transmission.
Great. Another question, Dr. Premchand. It says over here, my son has HIV positive and my life turned upside down. He's on medication. I'm scared to let other family members know about it. If we take all the precautions, can I expect AIDS not to develop for at least another 20 years? And she or he further adds, there'll be no need to let anyone know of it.
Okay. This is a very good question. And this is also a lot of lakhs of families are having the same doubt in India. The answer is never and ever. If anybody in the family come across with HIV positive, no other family member will get with a touch, with a kiss, with a sharing of utensils, sharing of a towel, or sharing of bathroom, sharing of restroom, and sharing of the bed. It never transmits like that. Only transmissible fluid is usually blood, only blood, and vaginal secretions and semen and all that are intercourse methods. But in any family, one person gets with HIV or AIDS, your support is more important, not the fear, not the panic, not the stigma. You please consider that person is also suffering with a problem like a diabetes, like a hypertension, like an asthma, like that only. You don't put any HIV patient in the family. No, don't put him in the panicky position. Support him, and you give the good words to him, and make his life more fruitful, and give medication to him, and give good food to him, and take and good interaction with him. And ultimately, I will tell one single word here. In Denmark, there is a study on this. A 24 years old man infected with HIV positive, they studied if any HIV positive patient not infected with hepatitis B or hepatitis C, if we give a proper ART medication and proper nutrition and proper follow-up and proper treatment of opportunistic infection, he can live like a non-HIV patient. This is a beautiful study in Denmark, and it happened long back. So today, HIV is not a dreadful disease. It is a suppressive disease like diabetes and hypertension. No need to worry at all. All the family members in the family should support the patient. That's all.
Yeah, Dr. Premchand, what struck me is this last line, and there'll be no need to let anyone know of it. So my question over here is that I'm not sure who's asking the question, whether the father or the mother, but is it okay to not let anybody else in the family or, you know, among friends know of it? I think what she wants to ask is, if I quietly give she or he, if I quietly give my son the treatment, is it okay to not let anybody else know of it? And can I expect AIDS not to develop for at least 20 years? So I think for 20 years, nobody needs to know that her son has AIDS,
There is no need to discuss with anybody about HIV or AIDS except in the family, because of he lives with the family. We have to take some precautions in the family. It should be in the family only. It should not be revealed to the outside world. You cannot, you need not reveal it.
Okay. Yeah, that's what I think. That's what I felt was his or her real concern. A very interesting question has come up, Dr. Premchand. Apparently, it says over here, it was in December 5th news that in Karnataka, residents of Morab had drained a lake because apparently an HIV positive woman committed suicide by jumping into the lake. So the residents emptied that lake completely. So he or she is asking, what is your opinion about it?
This is also, I heard a few days back only. You please listen the answer clearly, all the audience. You see, HIV virus is a very, very fragile virus, not like other viruses. If we put the HIV virus under the sun, suppose a HIV person get an accident on the road under the sun, suppose the blood is pouring on the road, how many hours the HIV virus lives is only few hours, maximum five hours under the sun. So there is no question of if a dead body of an HIV positive person found in a pond, the water in which present, if we keep silent for 24 hours, you need not touch the water. If you take up the body outside, you kept the water under the sun. It's always there, and naturally sun is coming down and focusing on the pond. Nothing will happen if you drink that water. Nothing will happen. That actually, why people are panicky means still our people in our society, there is so much of innocence and negligence and unawareness in education. These are all the factors. They don't know much about the actual virulence of the problem. So that in such a situation, nothing will happen to the water. It never and ever be transmissible. Never and ever be transmissible. But the thing is, we have to get out that body out, and we have to keep the water constantly for some time and let the sun comes. And after some hours, even if there is no blood in the body on the body, and not mixed with that particular water, then there is no question of transmission of the disease, even if you drink it or with any other source.
Okay, yeah.
Clear.
Dr. Premchand, would you like to add anything more to that?
No. Okay. Nothing will happen.
Something just struck me because of this question. You mentioned that the HIV virus does not survive under, let's say, any environment or a particular environment. So if a person, an HIV positive person, uses a particular washroom, and if a negative person, HIV negative person, uses that particular washroom, there is no danger to him, right? Him or her?
Not at all. Never.
Not at all. Okay. Yeah. So the next question that's coming up is, what kind of foods would you suggest for an HIV patient?
Food.
Yes, foods. Yeah, that's yes. What it says.
Fruits or food?
Food, diet, doctor.
Diet, yes. Okay. So usually what will happen in HIV patients, most of the patients in India and in HIV positive patients are suffering with anxiety and depression also. That is also one of the factors. They are unable to eat properly, and family's focus may be less, and stigma and other factors are also influenced. And society's comments and other things are also influenced on him or her. And ultimately, his diet may not be sufficient enough. Because in our country, people still think that HIV is a stigmatic disease, but not a stigmatic disease. We have to follow a strict, nutritious diet. That is more important. A patient of HIV needs more proteinaceous diet, and I will tell you the lineup. He must and should has to take milk with an added proteinaceous powder like Ensure or any other proteinaceous powder. Next comes egg. They must, if they take egg, means a white egg, and egg white. And yellow means it is having more cholesterol. They have to advise to take more egg, 2 eggs per day. And ultimately, HIV patients can take all fruits, every fruit they can take, unless otherwise they are having a diabetes or some other problem, which may be problematic if they take more sweets. So in such a case, and they have to take more amount of fish, more advisable is fish. And non-vegetarian is, and then comes the chicken. Chicken is more advisable. And next comes the mutton, may be less, very, very less advisable for HIV patients. So they have to take green leafy vegetables more and more. And all the fruits they can take, and more proteinaceous diet they have to take, and continuous constant rest also more important to the HIV patient. About nutrition, these are the small things which they can follow, like a normal individual. There is no restriction of any diet to the HIV patient. Moreover, a HIV patient has to take more calories because his immune system was already damaged. and his immunity system is diminishing gradually, so that they have to take more amount of nutrition regularly.
Doctor, I just noticed you said mutton should be less. So I'm assuming HIV patients need to take less of red meat. Am I correct? All red meats?
Yes.
All red meats should be less, right?
Yes, yes.
Okay.
Yes.
And fish, you mentioned all fish, but some fishes are rich in mercury. Like, I think a few would be like, salmon, or I'm not sure if it's salmon, but nowadays we have fishes which are rich in which are full of mercury. Will they not be harmful for HIV patients?
No. Usually, what more of our South Indians will take fishes which are not that much harmful to our health. We take fish. Almost some areas people will take fish regularly. In some people in and around living in the seashores and seaside areas. So very few fishes may be harmful. That is also not negligible. But anyway, of all the non-vegetarian foods, fish is the first preferable food for HIV or even the non-HIV also. Next comes chicken, the next comes mutton. Usually these are the follow. Next comes prawns also, we can take prawns.
Okay, yeah. I'll move on to the next question, doctor. Okay. It says okay. Over here, there is a pregnant woman who is HIV positive. Can her baby be born HIV free? Is there any treatment to give birth to an HIV free baby? That's the question.
Oh, this is a wonderful question. In India, they have conducted so many antenatal cases have been checked for HIV. Even in Guntur and other places also, even in Hyderabad. Nearly 16% of the women who are coming to the antenatal clinics are found positive. This is the picture in our country. So we have to control vertical transmission from mother to baby. Control is there. We have a fantastic medication in India. They are following and followed in CMC Vellore since 2004-2003. They followed. The thing is, the first antenatal checkup after diagnosing the mother is positive, we have to monitor the mother on the day one. We have to give the medication on the day when she was detected HIV positive.
Dr. Premchand, we cannot hear you.
No, it is okay, no problem.
Yeah. We could not, we lost you for a minute.
From the fourth month, we have to start with an appropriate treatment of ART to the mother. When we have to stop the treatment for the mother is, she must be continued the treatment after the delivery also. So there is a regimen of giving a three drug therapy to the mother. After the fourth month, we have to start. There is an every chance of stopping the transmission to the baby if the mother is adherent to the medicine, ART properly, and proper checkup, proper immunization also. Mother should be immunized, just like a tetanus and all that. And mother should be checked for other metabolic problems, anemia and hypertension. And other gynecological problems should be checked, follow-up should be checked very frequently in a HIV-positive mother. Then nutrition of the mother is also important. Medication is important. Support is important. And fetal growth we have to check regularly. How the fetus is growing, we have to check regularly. And at the end of the delivery, during the labor, actually during the labor, we have to protect the child. for not transmitting the disease from mother to child. That is, we have to add the medicine. Usually we give the gidovidin drops to the baby. We have to give the gidovidin for 28 days to the baby, and then we have to check for this HIV positive or not, and we have to check again after 3 months. Is there any chances of window period or anything between to the baby? So this is the beautiful treatment line present available. But anyway, this is the 80% of the transmission we can stop in India. 80% through this good line of medication, from mother to child transmission, we can protect the baby by 85% today.
Yeah. That's really good news. I hope this lady gets helped, whoever she is. Another question, doctor.
We have to educate the mother first, and we have to educate the family's people first, because it is like a glass we have to handle. This is that problem. HIV mother, antenatal mother, is like a glass. We have to handle properly until the end of the delivery, proper delivery. She has to give a good baby.
Yeah.
At the end.
Yeah, I'll move on to the next question, doctor. This one says, I recently had anal sex with someone I doubt who has HIV. What kind of symptoms should I expect to show up?
Okay, so usually in HIV patient, in the initial stages of the problem, night sweats is the number one. Number two is feverishness, number two. And number three, most important pathognomonic feature of the HIV is over the tongue, that is a hairy leukoplakia. Any patient, if you see the tongue of the patient, it looks like a white plaky areas over the tongue, white colored layers. You can see if same patient is suffering with generalized lymphadenopathy, with the fever, or with the diarrhea, or with the axillary lymphadenopathy, or itching in a particular area from the longer period, or vomitings, or nausea, and you please observe that white hairy leukoplakia over the tongue is the pathognomonic feature of the initial stages of the HIV. This is the wonderful pathognomonic feature anyone can found, even in not an expert can found, and any doctor can found it. It is the easiest method to detect HIV.
I just a thought crossed my mind, doctor. Do you think the person should wait for symptoms to show up in the first place?
Definitely, six weeks.
Or should he just go for the test?
Actually, this is another area of diagnosing the HIV in the very initial periods is PCR test, means polymerase chain reaction test.
Uh-huh.
We can detect the HIV virus within 1 week to 10 days after entering into the body.
Oh, so prior to that, it cannot be detected, is it?
Impossible.
Another question, doctor. Can I increase my CD4 count without treatment? Or what happens if I miss a dosage?
Actually, this is also a good question. Usually, CD4 count means our human body, T lymphocytes. If our T lymphocytes are the precursors, means soldiers to protect our body, our human body. If T lymphocytes were destroyed by the HIV virus, ultimately our CD4 count lowers, diminishes. That means your immune status of the human body will be decreased. And then whenever your body is CD4 count diminished, all the opportunistic infections, any virus, any bacteria, any protozoa, any virus can invade the body easily. So your body is not having any immune status. So what the question is, if you are not taking any treatment for HIV, means antiretroviral therapy, definitely your human body, your body is under threat of so many problems. You may not live like a non-HIV patient. You may not live. The life expectancy of the patient who is not taking any treatment will be very, very, very less when compared to the patient who is taking ART regularly, adherence to the drug, and taking proper treatment, and taking proper nutrition, and taking proper hygienic habits. And these are all the four factors which can influence to live more and more if you take some precautions. There is no question of not taking treatment in HIV, because so many medicines are there today. There are 10 types of regimens are available today in India. In India, with under which can be more suitable to any human, and it will be varies from human to human. We have to select the correct regimen to the patient. That patient can live like a normal man or a non-HIV patient. Today, the scenario has been entirely changed. We have to awaken the patients. We have to educate the patient. We have to aware the patient so that all HIV patients can live like us today.
Okay. I'll move on to the next question. However, I see we are getting more attendees joining us right now. So for your benefit, we will be posting this webinar on different channels, on different social media channels. You can check our Facebook, the Medlife Facebook page, or the Medlife LinkedIn page. We'll be posting the video of this webinar there, so you can catch up on whatever you have missed. Okay. So, another question, doctor. Can we get HIV from oral sex?
This is also a very good question. Actually, this is also a very good question. I will just tell you what type of you are asking about oral sex. There is a chances of getting HIV virus through this oral sex is 1:1,000. 1:1,000 in India. If I explain further, with inceptive anal intercourse, 1:1,000. With receptive vaginal intercourse, 1:1,000. With inceptive vaginal intercourse, 1:10,000 chances. With this question is, answer is 1:1,000 chances. 1:1,000. Out of 1,000 oral sex, a single one man may get or may not get. There's very, 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 very less chances. That too, the patient is having, that person is having any ulcers or inflammatory process in the mouth or somewhere in the tongue or somewhere. There is a chances of getting that is the 1 in 1,000 patients.
Okay. Doctor, this is the last question. I'm sorry, we will not be able to take up more questions. We are running out of time. So the last question is, how long can my HIV positive child live? She is 2 years.
Pardon?
How long can my HIV positive child live? She is 2 years. So this person has an HIV positive child who is 2 years. How long can, is the, how much is the child's life expectancy?
If we start the treatment early, if we treat the patient's metabolic health also checked on and off, properly monitored treatment of with the ART, the boy who is 2 years old, he or she, the baby, can live like a normal individual today. If today's procedure of medication, today's procedure of nutrition, today's knowledge, we can make him to live like a normal individual. There are some patients of mine who are living, they are HIV positive since they are 5 years old, now they are 18 years old. They are absolutely good, absolutely good. This is my practical experience that nothing will happen to the child if we properly treated with a good regimen of ART and good nutritional support, good family support. Everything should be maintained. He can live for a lifetime. No problem.
So the life expectancy should be as long as a normal person's, right, doctor?
Yes. Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
Okay. Dr. Premchand, thank you so much for joining us. Thank you so much for your time.
Thank you. And I am grateful to...
Yeah.
Can I speak for one minute?
Sure, doctor. Yeah.
No, first of all, I am thankful and grateful to your Medlife team. For giving me a chance like this to talk about HIV and AIDS in India awareness class. And hereafter also, I will be in with you to coordinate academically any type of interaction with Medlife people. I'm thankful to Anuja, thankful to Dr. Sushma, thankful to Chirag and other people. I don't know the names of the people. And I'm very much thankful to all the Medlife people who are in Bangalore.
Thank you so much, doctor. Thank you for your time. And with that, we end our webinar today. If you have any questions, you can always log on to medlife.com/consult. You can ask a question for free over there and expect a response within 48 hours. And for any issues, you can consult doctors online anytime, anywhere through Medlife e-consult. To do so, you can log on to medlife.com/consult. I repeat, medlife.com/consult. Thank you so much for joining us today, and we hope this webinar has helped you. Bye for now.